To this plastic bottle, I'm gonna add 15 milliliters of a clear liquid. Then I'm gonna cap the bottle and give it a shake. I want all that liquid to evaporate, not all of it, but as much as possible. Grab a match and light this on fire. Now you might have seen this demo before. In fact, I did it on this very channel. And yes, it is beautiful. In fact, I think it may be my favorite demo that I've ever done. But it's much more than just beautiful. In fact, this demo can tell us a lot about the chemistry of a very old, but also maybe revolutionary fuel that one particular car maker seems to be really into these days. And that fuel is ammonia. I was caught with my proverbial pants down. But I would never do that on this channel because I know that you don't like my body. Toyota has a joint venture with a Chinese state-owned car company called GAC. And in June of 2023, GAC announced that it had developed an internal combustion engine based on ammonia, NH3, that cut carbon emissions by 90%. Now, I have to admit that when I read that press release, I was just caught off guard. There's no other way to say it. I had zero clue that you could burn ammonia in an engine. I just didn't know. Now, to be honest, I had a real moment with this one because it got me wondering, is ammonia some sort of EV killer? Is it an internal combustion miracle? Like, what does Toyota know here that we don't? Are we gonna go back to burning liquid fuels? The first thing I did to wrap my head around these questions was actually just take a look at gas versus ammonia, chemically. Modern gasoline is a mixture of anywhere between 150 and 1,000 chemicals. Most of those are hydrocarbons, and it was designed to be burned in car engines. On the other hand, ammonia, wow, that was very loud. Ammonia is one chemical, NH3. Now to be specific, this is actually ammonia dissolved in water, so two chemicals, but who's counting? Regardless, it was not designed to be burned in engines. The only reason the world started producing millions and millions of tons of this stuff is because we needed fertilizer. But it turns out that ammonia can burn, and this is its combustion reaction. Now, this reaction puts out 2/3 less energy than gasoline per liter, so that's maybe not great. But on the plus side, look over here. Notice anything? There is no carbon in this fuel, which means there is no carbon in the exhaust. So we've solved climate change, and we can all go home. No, obviously not. Just because something will burn doesn't tell you much about how it burns. And so for me, that was the next important thing, is to figure out the difference between how ammonia burns versus how gasoline burns. Now, I could have done that by showing you a table like this one, which compares ammonia to gasoline to a couple other fuels across a whole range of chemical characteristics. And I could have picked one of those characteristics, let's say flame speed, and told you that it was important. But I didn't want to do that. What I actually wanted to do was burn some stuff. So let's go do that. I'm basically doing the same demo as before, except instead of a bottle, I'm doing it in this long plastic tube for a very important reason. I want to measure how fast the flame travels from this white ring of tape to this white ring of tape. Now I measured these and these are exactly 70 centimeters apart. 70 because I want to make the math as annoying as possible later. Now I'm not using actual ammonia here for a very good reason that's also relevant to Toyota and that we'll talk about later. Instead I'm using 91% isopropanol as a stand-in for ammonia and 100% isopropanol as a stand-in for gasoline. This first test is with the 91%. Okay, here we go. What you're watching here is a combustion reaction travel through this cylinder of fuel and air. The unreacted fuel is here in front of the flame. The combustion products are here behind the flame. And the combustion reaction itself is happening here in the flame itself. The speed that this flame travels is called the flame speed. After doing some annoying math, I can tell you that this flame is traveling at about 42 centimeters per second. This is 100% isopropanol, and its flame is traveling at 99 centimeters per second. The difference in the flame speed between these two concentrations is a factor of 2. One is double the other. Now, the difference between gasoline and ammonia is a factor of 6. In other words, gasoline's flame speed is 6 times as fast as ammonia's. 6 times. Look, I know that the demos in the bottles are more impressive, so I deeply apologize for that. I don't know what else to say. We're trying to get a flame speed measurement here, okay? We can't just burn things for the sake of burning them. We're sort of doing science. We're not really doing science, but for the purposes of a YouTube channel, we're doing science. Now, let's look at where these reactions happen in your car. And yes, I do have a switchblade box cutter. Yes, it's alive. All right, so this is one cylinder in an internal combustion engine. Here's what happens. The fuel and air enter through here, then the piston compresses the mixture, then the spark plug fires, which starts the combustion reaction, which releases a ton of heat, which increases the pressure and temperature, which pushes the piston back down, which turns the crankshaft, which eventually turns the wheels. Now let's go back here to this crucial point. So imagine the combustion reactions we saw downstairs, but happening right here in this cylinder. You can see that flame speed is absolutely critical for how the chemical energy released by the combustion reaction gets transferred to the piston. If your flame speed is too slow, it just won't push the piston fast enough and your engine will end up being low powered. But if your flame speed is too high, you could end up with a detonation instead of a combustion reaction, and that might actually damage your engine. This cylinder and the engine that it's part of was designed around gasoline's chemical properties, one of which is a flame speed of about 40 centimeters per second. So if you just take ammonia and you throw it in an engine like this, it will not combust like gasoline does, and your engine will run inefficiently, which could produce nitrogen oxides and lots of other stuff that's bad for the environment. Which is not good, because remember, the whole reason that we're doing this in the first place is to try and cut down on carbon emissions, not replace them with other ones. There is a solution though. Instead of using pure ammonia, you can add a promoter, which is a chemical that increases ammonia's flame speed. Interesting fact, the speed record for a crewed aircraft, which means an aircraft flown by people, is held by something called the X-15, which is a plane developed by NASA in the 1950s. And basically it consists of a rocket engine with two wings and a cockpit. Now, that rocket engine was powered by ammonia and a promoter, in this case, oxygen. Now, oxygen is a little aggressive for a car engine, so instead you can use hydrogen. Adding just 2% hydrogen by mass can turn ammonia into a perfectly combustible fuel with a flame speed roughly on par with gasoline. And the best part is, you don't even need to carry a separate hydrogen tank. You can just crack the ammonia to get your hydrogen. Very convenient. Ammonia has some downsides that are unrelated to its combustion chemistry. First, it's corrosive to copper, brass, zinc alloys, and some plastics, which can be found in many a gasoline engine. Also, it boils at minus 33 C. Thank you. Which means that it needs to be stored under that temperature, under pressure, or in a solid matrix. Now, none of those things are showstoppers, just means that an ammonia engine and fuel system would need to be designed from the ground up. But we can do that. We did it for other fuels, and we've been producing ammonia industrially for over a century. So what happened? Like, why aren't we driving around in ammonia cars right now? Why didn't ammonia as a fuel take off? I'm waiting for the, you know, boom, which I'm sure Elaine will add in post. Okay, so picture this. You are driving around in your ammonia-powered car, and by the way, I am actually driving a Toyota, and all of a sudden the fuel system springs a leak, and ammonia starts building up in the cabin. You would start to notice a very pungent aroma at around 5 parts per million. This is the part of the video where I smell the ammonia. Here we go. Of course, every bottle these days. Woo! Oh my God, it burns. I was told to expect like a rotten egg smell. That is not that. I'm getting like a, it's more like a punch in the nose. Oh God, yeah. Oh, that is awful. Mm-mm. Okay, we're done. Ammonia loves water. It will dissolve in any even remotely watery part of your body, and that means mucus. Mucus of your eyes, your nose, your throat. And when it dissolves, it forms ammonium hydroxide, and the hydroxide wreaks absolute havoc on your cells. It can destroy cell membranes, spilling cell guts everywhere. It denatures proteins, turning them into mush. And given enough time and at high enough concentrations, it can destroy almost every type of chemical bond that your body has. Remember about a year ago on this channel, I took a chicken drumstick and I threw it in sodium hydroxide and stuck it on the stove for an hour? The sodium hydroxide dissolved every gram of flesh off that bone. And there were not chunks floating around, okay? It was dissolved. Now, ammonium hydroxide is not quite that caustic, but it's not far off. So remember, you can smell ammonia at 5 parts per million.
and we crank it up a notch to 30 parts per million, then it would start to irritate your mucous membranes. You would notice it. At 140 parts per million, that irritation would become unbearable. At 500 parts per million is basically you're being tear gassed at that point. And at 1,000 parts per million, it can blister your skin, cause permanent lung damage, and even kill you. And by the way, these amounts are not that high. 30 parts per million is the equivalent of 120 tiny paint dots in this giant painting. Now, worst case scenario, you're driving along, the ammonia tank ruptures and releases all its ammonia. There is enough ammonia in there to kill an adult in minutes. We made a whole video about this. You should definitely check it out after getting to the end of this one, okay? It's like, don't jump the gun.
Okay, so my opinion on this, having smelled ammonia for the first time in this video, is that as a consumer fuel, as something that you would go to an ammonia station and fill your car with every week, it's kind of a pain in the butt. Now, let me just say that it's not like gasoline here is innocent and cute and cuddly. Gasoline has been known to kill via inhalation, and it's also way more flammable than ammonia. But we just don't think of gasoline as being that dangerous because we are so used to dealing with it every single week. But there are places and environments where the toxicity of ammonia matters a lot less than it would in your car. And conveniently, those places and environments are also much more difficult and expensive to switch over from fossil fuels to electricity. We have been producing, transporting, and using hundreds of millions of tons of ammonia since Haber and Bosch invented Haber Bosch. We made a whole video about that, you can check it out. Point is, I think if you have good regulations and good safety practices, ammonia is perfectly handleable. So, does Toyota know something we don't? I don't think so. But I also think ammonia combustion is not vaporware. I think it's real tech, and I think it could have a significant impact on climate change. Just not in your car.